Good morning. My name is Heather DeColange, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to this morning's Common Ground event, The Parents We Mean to Be, with Dr. Richard Weissbourd. I'd like to begin by thanking the Nueva School for hosting this morning's lecture. This year, Common Ground is celebrating the 15th year of bringing cutting-edge speakers, topics, and special events to the Bay Area. Our group started with just 8 member schools in 2002, and we now represent more than 10,000 families at 31 schools, from Hillsborough to San Jose. Nueva and its families are an important member of the 31-school consortium that sponsors Common Ground. And Common Ground's mission continues to be simply stated: to inform, engage, and inspire. This 15th anniversary season includes not only Richard Weissbourd, but also Frank Bruni, who will be speaking in conversation with Dr. Weissbourd later this evening at Menlo School. The 15th anniversary season will also include Scott Barry Kaufman speaking on creativity in January, followed by Drs. Yalda Yules and Laura Kastner speaking on parenting in the digital age in March. As your Common Ground reps, we will be sure to provide you with upcoming dates and times for these speakers. This morning's speaker, Dr. Richard Weissbourd, will discuss his book, The Parents We Mean to Be, How Well-Intentioned Adults Undermine Children's Moral and Emotional Development. For your convenience, Kepler's will be selling autographed copies of Dr. Weissbourd's book after the talk in the lobby out here. We hope that you'll stay in touch with Common Ground throughout the 15th anniversary season by visiting the website, commongroundspeakerseries.org. And at the conclusion of this morning's program, we'd appreciate if you'd take a moment to complete a short survey, hopefully you got it on the way in, and return it to one of the Common Ground reps by the door as you exit. Please take a moment now to turn off your cell phones or silence them. And to introduce this morning's speaker, it's my pleasure to welcome Nueva's head of school, Diane Rosenberg.
Thank you, Heather. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Nueva, and on behalf of Nueva School, we could not be more pleased to be hosting this morning's Common Ground Speakers Series. Before introducing this morning's speaker, Dr. Weissbourd, I'd like to thank the Common Ground organizers for 15 years of educating parents and teachers. We could not be more grateful for your tireless efforts. Will you join me in thanking our volunteers? Would our volunteers please stand? Thank you. Thank you. Dr. Weissbourd, a family and child psychologist, is a senior lecturer at Harvard Graduate School of Education, the Kennedy School of Government. He also co-directs Harvard's Making Caring Common project, which helps educators and parents raise compassionate, ethical children committed to their communities and to social justice. Dr. Weissbourd has spent decades researching and teaching about children's moral development. This morning, he'll share with us his recommendations for essentially parenting practices to guiding our children leading ethical and moral lives. Dr. Weissbourd is also the lead author of Turning the Tide, Inspiring Concern for Others and the Common Good Through College Admissions, a recent report from Making Caring Common. The initiative seeks to reform the college admissions process and encourage students, high schools, and colleges to place greater value on meaningful ethical and civic engagement. The report has been endorsed by more than 120 colleges and universities and widely discussed in the nation's leading news and education publications. Dr. Weissbourd will be speaking about the report, as you heard earlier this evening, in conversation with Frank Bruni at Menlo School. Dr. Weissbourd has advised on school reform and family policy at the local, state, and federal levels. He's written from numerous scholarly and popular publications, including the New York Times, American Prospect, and the New Republic. He's also the author of The Parents We Mean to Be, which we'll hear this morning, and The Vulnerable Child, which was named by the American School Board Journal as one of the top 10 education books of all time. Please join me in welcoming this very special speaker this morning, Dr. Rick Weissbourd. Thank you.
Good morning. Great to see you all. And I'm delighted and honored that you're interested in this topic. I also just wanted to note that at these events, I've been counting the number of fathers, and I do see it. There are a few fathers speckled in the crowd, which is great. But I was just at the airport. One of the things that I've been tracking is you know, there are now baby stations in men's restrooms, and this is just over the last 10 years, and Obama actually has a new regulation about how there have to be baby stations in men's restrooms, but I have never actually seen a father use one of these baby stations before. And I was at the airport, and the baby station was out. I got so excited, and I walked up behind this dad to look at the baby, and he had his laptop computer out. So I felt like maybe we're not making so much progress on this front. Anyway, I want to try and do, can everyone hear me okay? Okay. I want to try and do three things today. I want to try and lift kids out of what I think is a mud of misconceptions about how they become good and ethical and moral people. I also want to talk about what I think are the real threats to kids' moral development. And I worry about the media, I worry about peer groups, but what I worry about primarily, though, is our modern intense focus on our kids' achievement, their self-esteem, and their happiness. The degree to which we have elevated achievement as the primary goal of child raising and demoted concern for others and concern for the common good. And finally, I want to talk about solutions. I want to talk about what we can do as schools and what we can do as parents. And finally, the election is certainly at the forefront of my mind, and thinking about how to move forward and lead an ethical life as a result of this election. And, you know, some of you may have very different political positions about this, which I respect, but I'm very happy to engage in conversation about what I think the election means for us as parents and how we can engage our children in moving forward. So let me start with the first one. And let me just make sure this is working. So when you ask Americans what's wrong with kids today, they are apt to say, the biggest problem with kids today, public agenda survey shows this, is that they don't know right from wrong. And we spend a lot of time in sports fields and in schools chanting about values like honesty and fairness and caring and respect. It's hard to go into a school and not see a poster on the wall that says honesty, fairness, kindness, respect, some combination of those things. And I think we have this idea that the more we chant these values or the more we repeat these values, the more likely they are to stick. And I became concerned about this maybe 15 years ago when my daughter was about 6 years old. And she was in her room with a couple of her friends. And every time her friends or my kids' friends come over, they know they're in danger of being accosted by an ethical dilemma. So I went into her room and I gave her an ethical dilemma from a popular character education program. And the ethical dilemma is, should you be, and they're 6 years old. The ethical dilemma is, should you be honest with your teacher if you forget your homework? And one of my daughter's friends said to me, do you want me to tell you what you want to hear, or do you want me to tell you the truth? And another one of my daughter's friends says, I know I'm supposed to say I should be honest about that, but I don't know any 5 or 6-year-old who would be honest about that. And I started digging the research, and I realized that by the time kids are 5 or 6 years old, they basically know these values. They know that honesty, caring, fairness are important. In adolescents especially, because they know these values, they can feel patronized by this chanting and these lectures about values. They can learn what they become very nimble at, very adroit at, is parroting back what adults want to hear. I am clearly for these values, but I don't think the big issue is moral literacy, the first one on the list. I think the big issue is moral identity. How do these values become a deep part of the self? How do children develop a deep internal commitment to these values? For the Dutch who rescued the Jews in World War II, they don't describe it as a choice. They describe it as a reflex, as something that was as natural to them as breathing. For Nelson Mandela, for Martin Luther King, for Gandhi, they don't describe their ethical choices as choices. They again describe them as something that emerged from a fundamental sense of their identity, a fundamental sense of who they are. And I think that has to be our goal. How do we make these values part of our children's identity? And I don't think we can do that unless we are as deliberate and intentional and systematic about cultivating in our kids an ethical life as we are deliberate and intentional about cultivating in them achievement and happiness. And I want to return to this later. Let me move on to the second moral capacity on the list that I think is important, and that is moral awareness, circle of concern, empathy. There's a lot of talk about empathy in the country right now. There are a lot of social emotional development programs that are about promoting empathy, and I clearly think empathy is very important, but often when we talk about empathy, we are talking about it like it's a muscle, like you have to strengthen, you have to have stronger empathy, or it's like a tank, you have to fill up the empathy tank. But when you think about it, the much bigger issue in many ways is, you know, almost everybody has empathy for somebody. They have empathy for their family, they have empathy for their friends. Some people have very strong empathy for their family and for their friends. But they don't have empathy for people who are different from them. They don't have empathy for people who are different from them in race, in class, in gender, in sexual orientation. We have kids who are very kind to their family and friends and neighbors, but the bus driver or the school secretary is outside their radar, is not in their circle of concern. I think our work as parents is about developing empathy, but it is primarily about expanding kids' circle of concern. It is about expanding their spheres of concern and obligation to include many different people, types of people who are unlike them. You know, I think Harvard students, by and large, are nice people, but they leave their crap all over the dining room and in the halls, and it doesn't occur to them that somebody has to pick up that crap because the custodian is not in their on their radar or in their circle of concern. And so this is our primary work, is this work of expanding kids' circle of concern. Let me move on to the last one, which is managing destructive emotion. So the emotions are the engines of moral development, and when you think about a time when you transgressed or when you violated a principle that was very important to you, I'm sure it wasn't because you didn't know the principle was important. My guess is because you were overcome by an emotion of some kind. Shame or anger or frustration. I still play men's basketball, and it's sort of a laboratory for understanding moral regression. And I was playing the other day, and I'm playing against, we're playing pickup basketball, and somebody on the other team says, "Who's covering the old guy?" And I'm looking around like, "Who are they talking about?" And a guy on my team said, "Well, Rick, that would be you that they're talking about." He's talking about lack of self-awareness, by the way. But you know, now I'm boiling over, like game on, like let's bring it. And you know, and even in these sort of minor ways, in these contexts, it is these emotions that cause us to transgress. And I just want to mention two emotions that I think of as especially important. One is a positive emotion, and that's gratitude. I saw on your kindness wall a couple of kids talking about gratitude. Gratitude is, you know, and the Greater Good Science Center here in Berkeley has been wonderful about promoting research on gratitude. It's so important to our well-being, but it's also a profoundly moral emotion. When we can appreciate what we have, we're also able to appreciate what other people don't have. And so I think it's very important to cultivate gratitude in our kids. You know, we live in a much less religious society, so we don't cultivate, we don't have blessings, for example, at the dinner table. Things like simple blessings at the dinner table can be very important. For people who are, you know, outside your family and friends, can be very important for cultivating gratitude. The other emotion I want to mention is shame, because shame is at the root of so much that is troubling. It's the root of behavior problems. It's at the root of delinquency. It's at the root of violence. James Gilligan has written a great book about the relationship between shame and violence. And I just want to ask you, how many of you know the difference, or somebody want to offer a definition of the difference between shame and guilt? How is shame different than guilt? God, your hand came up quick. Yeah, go for it. And shame is about who you are. Great. And any other thoughts about this? Yeah. Well, I think you both have identified the two big components of the distinction. So, you know, guilt is usually about a deed. It's about an action that you took that violated one of your ethical standards or principles. And the good news about guilt is that guilt insists on and reveals a path to repair itself. You feel guilty and you can apologize. You can make amends. Shame is about defects in the self, as you said, and particularly the public exposure of defects in the self. And the problem with shame is it's very hard to release shame. So, you know, I asked my 93-year-old mother about a painful childhood memory. I won't ask all of you about a painful childhood memory, but my guess is that you will remember, if you think about it, an episode of shame. And that's because of the way shame festers and collects in the self. And I think that's what makes shame so dangerous. And I don't think we should, you know, when we punish our kids, they're going to feel some shame, and that's appropriate. Shame and guilt are what bind us as a society. You need shame and guilt to have a conscience. But I do worry about immoderate shame. And, you know, I worry especially, and this is related to the next topic I'm going to talk about, I worry especially about the degree to which we have so few metrics of success in childhood in many communities. And I don't know this community, but in many communities, the only ways to succeed are to achieve at a high level, to be popular, or to be athletic. And there are a lot of kids who are feeling shame that there's something wrong with them because they're not popular or athletic or high achievers. And many of those kids are wonderful kids. They're feisty and soulful and funny and kind and many other qualities that we are not identifying and recognizing. And so I worry about how few metrics we have for success in this in this country and in many communities. And I think it's vitally important to create more metrics of success so many more of our kids can feel positive about themselves and have the kind of affirming experiences that combat shame. Okay, I want to move on to what I think the challenge is. Yes, indeed. Thank you. That better? Okay, great. Thank you. Please let me know if you're having a hard time hearing. So I want to talk about what I think about is the right now to developing a moral identity and to developing moral awareness and often to managing these destructive feelings. Over the last 5 years or so, we have been asking students this question. Is it more important to you that you're caring, that you're high achieving, or that you're happy? We have also been asking them, how do you imagine your parents would rank those things for you? Is it more important to your parents that you're caring, high achieving, or happy? How do you imagine your teachers would rank these things for you? We have now asked this question, this is based on about 10,000 students, but because we have sort of parallel data here, but we've now asked this question to about 50,000 students across the country, in every demographic group you can imagine, every region of the country that you can imagine. And I wanna just give you a sense about what kids say. I want to also say that we spend a lot of time with kids asking them to define, what do you mean by happiness? What do you mean by caring? What do you mean by achievement? And people clearly mean different things by these things. And what do you see as the relationship between happiness and caring and high achievement? So here's what we found, that about 80% of kids are identifying achievement and happiness as more important than caring. So in a way, for 85% of kids, some aspect of personal success is more important to them than caring for other people. And I want you to pause and just think about that for a minute, because I think the degree to which we have elevated achievement and happiness as the goals of child raising and sidelined concern for others may be unprecedented in the history of this country. And I want to talk a little bit later about why that is. I mean, one reason that it is that throughout most of our history, it was mother's job, and it should have been father's too, to raise children who were good citizens, who were respectful people and good citizens. That is no longer the primary purpose of parenting in most communities. These are some of the responses that we got in our qualitative interviewing. Some youth are clearly, and this is not most youth, and I don't want to cartoon youth, but some youth are clearly highly focused on their happiness. It's important to focus on oneself over others. Happiness is my primary goal in life. Achievement and moral goodness are only important if they make me happy. If you are not happy, life is nothing. This one is so sobering. Life is nothing. After that, you want to do well. And after that, expend any excess energy on others. So when you talk to parents, when you survey parents, when we've surveyed parents, when other people survey parents, and you ask them, well, what are your primary goals in child raising? They don't say achievement. They say caring. They're more likely to say that caring is more important than achievement. But when we ask kids, what's most important to your parents, achievement, caring, or happiness, what do you think they say? You got it. Well, they are even more likely to think that achievement is important to their parents than it is to them. So there is this rhetoric reality gap. There's a gap between what parents are espousing and what kids are hearing. Kids were 3 times more likely to agree than disagree with this statement on my survey. My parents are prouder if I get good grades in my classes than if I'm a caring community member in class and school. Similarly with school adults. So, you know, I wasn't surprised that kids said that their teacher's primary job was to advance their academic achievement. But I don't know if I was surprised, but I was interested that when you ask teachers across the country, what's your primary goal in educating? They don't say achievement. They say raising caring kids, or they're more likely to say raising caring kids. So again, there is this gap between what educators believe or are espousing, why they entered the profession, and what kids are hearing or what kids are absorbing. There's a lot of talk about grit these days. Angela Duckworth has done some terrific work about grit. But I also want to say that this conversation about character can get dominated by the conversation about grit and performance character. And there's sort of a grit kindness war going on a little bit out there, because there's a difference between performance character and ethical character. And we are focused a lot on performance character, on things like grit now. We are not focused very much on ethical character, like things like fairness. And you can see it in this graph, the degree to which kids rank hard work is more important than fairness. And again, the emphasis on performance character over ethical character. And I want to just clarify, you know, and you know this because you're parents at the school. I saw some of the kids at this school walking in. There are a lot of wonderful kids out there. I'm not saying there aren't many ethically inspired, wonderful kids. I loved the kindness wall. I got to see the kindness wall this morning. So I'm talking about general trends here. There are clearly many kids who are exceptions to these general trends. It's consistent with other research, Robert Putnam's research on increases in individualism and the decline of social capital, Sarah Conrad's research in Michigan on declines in empathy. And I think the problem may be the tacit messages that we are sending to kids day to day. I mean, this is what I think explains this gap between the rhetoric and the reality, the gap between what we're saying and espousing and what kids are hearing. And, you know, when my kids were young, I sometimes didn't require them to reach out to a friendless kid on the playground or to write a thank you note. Or our conversations in ways I think I wasn't quite aware of were consumed in high school by achievement talk and college talk. And in all these subtle ways, I think I was privileging their achievement and their happiness over their concern for others. I was interviewing a couple, and they were trying to decide whether their daughter should be able to quit the soccer team. And the mother says, let her quit. She's 17 years old. Mother says, let her quit. She's not having any fun. And the father says, but she's a great soccer player. It'll help her get into college. And I realized at some point that neither of them asked, does she have any responsibility to the team? And a few weeks later, I was talking to my wife, and my daughter wanted to quit a dance group that she was in. And I said to my wife, let her quit. She's not having any fun anymore. And my wife said something like, excuse me, Mr. Moral Development. We can't just let her quit the group. You know, she has to at least think about, does she have some responsibility to this group? And in many communities, I think we are not telling our kids they have a responsibility to their classrooms as communities, to their schools as communities, to their teams as communities, to their neighborhoods as communities. They have responsibility to things that are larger than themselves. And again, another subtle way in which we privilege their individual well-being or their investment in the common good and in their community. The irony of this is that I think all this focus on our kids being happy isn't even making them happier. And I think that all of the maneuvering that many parents are doing to get their kids on winning teams, they won't suffer losses, or the swooping in on playgrounds to resolve peer conflicts very quickly, are depriving kids. The allergy to adversity, the allergy to our kids experiencing adversity, is depriving them of precisely those coping strategies that are going to be very important for their long-term well-being. I don't know if this happens in this community, but in my community, I also see something going on with playgrounds with parents of young kids. I will see parents, and I probably did this myself, so I don't want to seem too critical, but I see parents with their young kids noting their kids' feelings every 10 minutes. That must make you frustrated. That must make you sad. That must make you angry. It's like the mood police are out, the mood meteorologists. And, you know, I think it is really important to get kids to identify and articulate their feelings. It's especially important to get boys to identify and articulate their feelings. But the degree to which we're doing this in many communities, I think it's causing kids to be hyper-focused on the self, to make their own inner lives drama, to be self-occupied in ways that aren't helpful to them. I think we would do better to spend equal time, at least, getting them to tune into other kids on the playground. And the irony here is if they tune into other kids on the playground, if we're less focused on them and more focused on them tuning into other people, they're going to have better relationships their whole lives. They're going to be better friends. They're going to be better parents. They're going to be better mentors. They're going to be better romantic partners. And those relationships, sturdy, robust, deep, loving relationships, are the strongest source of happiness that we have. So if we want our kids to be happy, we would do better getting them focused on other people and getting them so focused on themselves. I want to just clarify the one thing in saying that, and that's that I don't think we should tell kids to care about other people because it will make them happy. And I say that, and I emphasize that clarification because, you know, when my kids were young, I did say things to them like, be nice to other kids because then they'll be nice to you. Or pass the ball because then other kids will pass the ball back to you. But there are two things wrong with that. You know, one is it still makes their happiness the goal. It doesn't make other people's happiness the goal. The other is that, you know, I think we've lost this notion that morality involves sacrifice. I mean, morality sometimes means standing up for an important principle at a cost to oneself. Standing up for a friend. I mean, many of us are thinking about this these days. Standing up for a friend or being an ally at a cost to oneself. Going to a faculty meeting. Sorry, just kidding. Taking care of somebody with Alzheimer's. I mean, there are all these things that we should do that involve suffering at a cost to ourselves. And I worry we have lost our sense of morality for its own sake, that we should tell kids to be nice because it's nice. We should tell them to do what's right because it's right. We should tell them to be moral because it's moral. Okay, a few caveats. We are not saying that caring is still important, and we are not saying in our research and in our reports that caring, happiness, achievement are mutually exclusive. Of course they're not. I expect many of you are caring, high achieving, and happy. We are saying we're out of balance and that this balance matters, and that to a degree that is unprecedented, we have elevated achievement and happiness and demoted caring. There are also large race, class, and cultural differences, and gender differences in what I'm talking about. I mean, you know, there are a lot of kids I'm worried about being too selfish. There are other kids I'm worried about being too organized around other people. I worry especially about girls who are too organized around other people. And I don't think the agenda for them is to get more oriented around other people. I think it's to become more assertive. So there are, you know, I'm talking about averages here. I'm not talking about individuals. There are also big race, class, and culture differences. There are very strong traditions in many African-American communities and many immigrant communities of the importance of the collective, of the importance of responsibility for your communities. Immigrant kids, you may know this, when they first get here, are doing better than their across almost every immigrant group. They are doing better than their non-immigrant American peers on almost every emotional and ethical measure we have. They're less likely to be delinquent, they're less likely to have behavior problems, they're less likely to have depression, anxiety. Lots of reports from teachers about how wonderful immigrant kids are. the longer they're here, the worse they do. And by the third generation, they tend to be doing as bad or worse than their non-immigrant American peers. And I emphasize this because, as you know, we're at this moment, and we hear this in the election, we hear this on the airwaves, that immigrant families are a threat to America's moral culture. But the data seem to suggest exactly the opposite, that it's America's culture that's a threat to immigrant kids. And there are very important collective traditions in immigrant families. There is not this intense focus on how kids are feeling moment to moment. Again, this is a puzzle with many pieces, many different types of immigrant families, many different pathways here. But we are, I think, seeing collective cultures that are colliding with very individualistic cultures. And it is, I think, important to preserve and to learn from these collective cultures in very important ways. Okay. Why these change in the values we prioritize? What's going on here? Why have we seen this shift? Well, one thing that's shifted is that public schools in this country were founded, I don't know if you know this, not to promote academic achievement, but to promote good citizens. That was their primary reason that was their primary mission. Most independent schools in this country were also founded to promote ethical character, not academic achievement. That is not true. That is not true for the great majority of schools around the country anymore. Colleges, like mine, were founded to promote ethical character. How they defined ethical character may make some of us very uncomfortable now, that many of them are around the gentlemanly virtues. But when I ask students at Harvard now, what does Harvard stand for? They say, privilege, elitism, excellence. I cannot find an ethical value. And that's a real concern, that our colleges that used to stand for ethical values are not standing for ethical values anymore. There has been an evaporation of participation in religious life. Most of you, I think, know that. And I'm not saying something here for or against religion. I mean, this is a hugely complicated issue. But I do think there are structures in religion that are very important to pay attention to. And there are rituals in religions that are very important to pay attention to. Rituals are communities where adults commonly stand for a common set of ethical values, where they are engaging kids in ethical questions, where there are things like confirmation ceremonies and bar and bat mitzvahs that should have ethical content, where kids are thinking about their responsibility for their communities and their ancestors. They are places where you can fuse a moral life and a spiritual life, when you can be taught about your obligations to your descendants and your obligations to your ancestors, and you can be about caring ethical traditions. And again, I'm not saying we should become more religious, but I do think it's imperative that we think about how do we reproduce some of these powerful rituals and practices and structures and practices in religious life in non-religious settings, in secular settings. Okay, I'm gonna come back to this. So I want to just mention a couple of practices that I think are very tied to this focus on achievement and happiness that I'm concerned about. And by the way, I also want to leave plenty of time for your questions and thoughts. I really would love to engage you in thinking about these issues. One of them is praise, and we live in an era where there is a blizzard of praising going on. And I mean, telling kids they're wonderful and special a lot, but also just constant praising, the constant noise sometimes of praise. And I got concerned about this maybe 10 or 12 years ago when I was watching a father and son play catch. And every time this kid caught the ball or threw the ball, the father complimented it. And when the kid dropped the ball, the father said, "Nice try." So there was not a single act that didn't get a compliment in this game of catch. And there are sports programs that are telling parents to praise kids 5 times for every single time they criticize them after every game, and to tell their parents, and for parents to tell their kids they're proud of them before every game. And this stuff gets in your head. This stuff got in my head. And when my son was maybe 13 or 14 years old, I was driving him to a basketball game. I said, "David, I just want you to know I'm really proud of you." And he said to me, "What is the matter with you, Dad?" And I think the reason I think the reason he said that is that he knows I'm proud of him, and he felt patronized by it. Like, why do you feel this need to prop me up right now? I know you're proud of me, and I think that's the risk that kids know when they've really accomplished something and when they haven't, when praise is meaningful and when praise isn't meaningful. When we're praising kids all the time, we're also judging them all the time. This is not a relaxed game of catch between a father and a son. Even though it's compliments, it becomes a performance. This is not a meditative, relaxed bonding moment. It becomes another type of performance. And Carol Dweck, who I'm sure many of you know, has written wonderful stuff, has wonderful work around praise, and she talks about how this constant assessment can cause kids to become more competitive, more prone to tear other kids down, more threatened by other people. I think my biggest worry about it is I think it's based on a false notion of how the self grows. That we have this notion that the self is like a tank and that the more we praise it, the more we fill the tank. But I don't think the self grows by being praised. I think it grows by being known. I think it grows when we as adults really have time to spend with our children and to distill and understand and appreciate who they are and to reflect back that understanding and to help in the choreography of their lives in ways that reflect a deep understanding and appreciation of who they are. And I don't think praise can be that substitute. And some parents don't have time but can still appreciate. I don't think praise can be a substitute for that kind of knowing and deeper appreciation. So I just want to offer some guidelines about this. I certainly think we should occasionally praise our children and tell our children how wonderful and special they are, but it should be based on some accumulated sense that they really are wonderful and special. I think, as Carol Dweck says, praise should be specific. You know, much more helpful to give kids some specific feedback. The follow-through on your throw was great today. I mean, that kind of information is very helpful and motivates improvements and motivates and reinforces wanting to play catch. I think we got to be child and context specific. There are some kids who soak up praise, who seem, you know, I think need to be weaned from praise some. I had a child like this. There are other kids who are almost allergic to praise. So I think we sort of need to learn how to help handle a compliment of some kind. And I think we got to think about why at this time in our history are we praising our kids so much? And how much does it have to do with us? You know, sometimes when I'm very busy, when my kids were younger, I would come home and start praising them a lot as if praise could substitute for time. I'd start telling my daughter how wonderful she was when I had been traveling a lot and on the road. And praise doesn't substitute for time. I also think sometimes when we're praising our kids, we're projecting. And it's really us who need the praise. So, you know, I think we have to really be able to disentangle what about this praise is for our kids? When is it really in our kids' benefit? And when is it really more about us? I want to talk about one other trend that I also think is related to this focus on happiness achievement, and this is a tremendous trend in many ways, and it's our desire to be close to our kids. Some of us will say that our kids are our best friends, that we have very close reciprocal relationships with our kids, that we share more of our lives with our kids, they share more of their lives with us. And again, I think this is a tremendous trend in many ways, but it's a giant social experiment that we are on. There may be no culture in history that has thought of parenthood this way. And I do have concerns about it. And my concerns about it emerged when I was on a flight with another father, and I was having a conversation with him that I find myself having with other dads. And the conversation goes, other dads around my age, goes something like this. I love my dad very much, but he was a remote man in many ways and not an emotionally available man in some ways. And we were talking about how we really wanted to have different kinds of relationships with our kids and more reciprocal relationships with our kids. And this other dad said to me, I know exactly what you mean. I hang out with my son and his friends a lot. We get stoned. And I'm like, you know, that's not exactly what I mean. This is going to be a long flight. But I think that's what the problem is. I think this conflation of we can be close to our kids but without being their friend and without acting as if in many respects they are the same as us, or that we don't have more wisdom than them, than they do. And I emphasize this because for a few reasons. One is it's really important that kids go through stages where they idealize us. That is one way in which they develop a moral identity. That is one way in which they adopt our ethical values. And when we treat them as equals in this sense or as best friends, we can compromise that process. I think we can compromise that process of idealization. I also talk to a lot of parents who become very emotionally dependent on their kids and dependent on their kids' recognition and support and moment-to-moment love in ways that really makes it hard to discipline or set high ethical standards because they can't, they're having trouble with their kids being angry at them. I had trouble with my kids being angry at me. But sometimes we gotta let our kids be angry at us if we're gonna hold them to high ethical expectations and if we are gonna discipline them. And, you know, the third thing I'll say is, you know, I don't know, you have kids of different ages, but when my oldest son was going into adolescence, I had some separation issues. Like, I was having trouble letting go of him, and I heard a psychologist on the radio talking about parents these days having letting go disorder. And you see this as kids enter adolescence and they begin to separate, and you also see this as kids enter college. And it's really important for us to let our kids separate, you know, our ability to really appreciate them as separate is so important to their ability to appreciate other people as separate. And I think a lot of us are having trouble allowing our kids to individuate or to separate. So I just have a couple of thoughts about this. I do think that the bottom line is here, we have to be our kids' parents and not their friends when those two things collide. I also think that it's really important to be able to disentangle our needs from our kids' needs. And this is a really hard one. I know this is a really hard one, but I think it's valuable to ask somebody you really trust and respect to make sure to tell you if they feel like you're too enmeshed with your kid or too entangled with your kid. Parenting this country is probably the most important thing we do, and it's an intensely private experience in this country. There are many other countries where people expect feedback about their parenting. This is the most important thing we do when we never get feedback. And it's so hard to get feedback. I know how hard it is to get feedback. I had a friend who I asked to do this, and he told me that he thought I was favoring one of my children over the other, and he's not my friend anymore. No, I'm kidding. he's still my friend. And, you know, it was a really hard, my kids were like 2 or 4 years old, and it was a really hard thing for me to hear, but a really important thing for me to hear. And, you know, so I do think it's highly valuable to have one or two people who are willing to give you that kind of candid feedback. And the last thing I want to say about this is if you look at what's happening in the culture, and I don't know about this community, parents are having fewer and fewer friendships. Adults are having fewer and fewer friendships. They are spending more time on watching TV, using technology of one kind or another, more time alone, more time working. And it is really important, I think, if we're not going to become too dependent on our kids to be able to maintain some of our key friendships. Okay, I want to move on to the focus on achievement and achievement pressure, which I know has been a concern in this community. And as you know, or as you may know, any of you know Sunaya Luthar's research by any chance? A few of you know. Anyway. So there is research that is showing, you know, across the country that kids, and this is Sunaya Luthar's research, that affluent kids are, in terms of the risk factors, are doing about as badly as low-income kids. That rates of depression, anxiety, substance abuse in affluent communities are about as high as they are in low-income communities, despite the many obvious stresses that low-income kids endure. The causes of those problems are different and the consequences are different, but the rates are about the same. Rates of depression among affluent teenage girls is about twice as high as it is in the general population. And there's good research that shows that achievement pressure is one, and this is again a puzzle with many pieces, that achievement pressure is one of the drivers of this. And there are some parents, you know, as you know, that are doing, you know, in my mind, outright unethical things to promote their kids' achievement, getting their kids falsely diagnosed as having ADD, so they'll have more time on the SAT, threatening to sue guidance counselors who don't write good recommendations for their kids, paying $50,000 for college counselors. I mean, there are some things that I really worry about, but I don't, those are a fairly small fraction of parents, although I think they do influence other parents, and that becomes a concern. More commonly, I think there's a community service Olympics going on in many communities. Who can get the most high-profile community service opportunity? I was interviewing two parents in New York, and one of them had started a school for their child in Botswana, so she could say on her college application that she started for a community service project. She started a school in Botswana, and you know, this set off a mini competition. Another parent got their kid an AIDS clinic in Guam. And again, these are not the typical parents, but they can affect the other parents. I think the bigger problem is much more pervasive and it's much more subtle. And I think it's the contradictory and sometimes hypocritical messages that we are sending to our kids about achievement. It's this rhetoric reality gap. The kids notice when their parents say high achievement doesn't matter, but then pay jaw-dropping amounts of money to get their kids SAT tutors, sometimes beginning in the sixth grade. Still other parents that we talk to sent their kids messages that seemed designed to take the pressure off, but couldn't possibly take the pressure off. One parent I talked to said that while it was important to her that her children go to great colleges, her husband felt differently. He would be happy if they went to Swarthmore. Other kids were aware of another kind of hypocrisy, other teens that we talked to. As parents, we say, and I said this to my kids, we want you to go to a great college because you'll have many career options. You can become a doctor or a lawyer or a corporate leader. But many young people we talked to came to question what kind of choices they were really being given when they were growing up in cultures with the pressure to achieve was so fierce. Were they really being given the option of becoming carpenters or florists or firefighters or preschool providers or teachers or many other things that were not high status? Were their career options being expanded, or were they implicitly, in fact, being narrowed in many ways? And hearing these stories, I decided to clarify with my own son how I felt about this. This was many years ago. This was 10 years ago now. My son was probably 16, 17 years old. He was a junior in high school in the spring. This college frenzy was setting in. We went for a father-son walk one night, a lovely night. We were having a really nice moment, and I said to him, you know, I just want you to know that I don't want you to care about status in this college choice. I want you to go to a college that's a good fit for you. And he said in a pretty nice way, but he said, you know, Dad, that's about the biggest crock of crap I have ever heard. He said, you know, you teach at Harvard. My cousins are going to these high status schools. This is what people in my community do. Like, you can take the high road here, in a way, because you know there are all these forces that are doing the muscling for you, that this is so in the water in our community. And, you know, he sort of exploded our nice father-son moment, but he was right, you know, and it set me along a path, a very important path of really thinking about this more deeply and thinking about the constellation of forces that he was dealing with in his life. And I will tell you that, you know, my kids are older now. They're 26, 24, and 21. And they went to Tulane and University of Denver and Skidmore. And I could not be prouder of them. And they have so many career options. They have so many options. And I think back about those days, and I feel like I was caught up in some kind of fever that really doesn't make any sense. And I'm going to be talking about this tonight, but there's a reality out there that there are hundreds of great colleges in this country. And the degree to which we are focused on this handful of colleges is a terrible problem and is creating a lot of stress for our kids. So I'm a recovering achievement addict, and I do think there's an important path forward here. I want to just suggest to you some very concrete things, and I handed out a document that has some red flags for you, that, you know, some of the unconscious ways in which I think that, you know, achievement pressure can become too much. It should be a red flag when our self-esteem plummets, when a child does poorly on a big test. It should be a red flag when our conversations with our kids are consumed by achievement talk, when we're popping vocabulary cards at the dinner table and on vacations constantly. It should certainly be a red flag if our kids, and this will happen to many of you, it's happening in communities across the country, are not eating well or sleeping well or showing signs of debilitating stress as a result of achievement. I think Wendy Mogul, you know, urges the 20-minute rule, spend no more than 20 minutes thinking about your kid's achievement every day. That might be a hard rule, but that seems like an important rule to follow. And, you know, Charles Ducey, who used to be the head of the Bureau of Study Council at Harvard, you know, about 30% of Harvard students are medicated at some point for anxiety and depression at some point in their 4 years at Harvard. And I was asking him why this is. And he said to me, you know, I know it might seem trite, but a lot of the work of counseling with these kids is getting them to find some passion or frame or larger principle for their achievement. A lot of these kids have just been achieving to achieve. And once they find some passion or purpose, you know, we find that a lot of the stress begins to dissipate. So I think that is part of the work from an early age. Is, you know, can be much harder for young kids. But beginning to uncover passions and purposes. I also think we have to do a lot of work to understand the irrational forces that can cause us to push our children, our competitive feelings with other parents, our status concerns. And I just want to share with you one graph, because when, you know, this, you can see the graph. We also ask parents, what do other parents in your community value? So you say you value caring over achievement, but what do other parents in your community value? And you can see by an overwhelming majority, parents think other parents value achievement over caring. So we're in this situation where a great majority of us think the problem is a great majority of other parents. And that can't be right. So I am encouraging you to do the work, and the work that I, you know, have tried to undertake and continue to undertake, of realizing that the problem in many ways isn't them. The problem in many ways is us. And we do have work to do. And I think when we do the work, we can have really wonderful conversations with our kids about things like recognition and status and power and how much they matter in certain contexts and how much they really don't matter and how much they are often not central to what it means to lead a meaningful life. Let me just say also that I think this is a kind of public health epidemic. It's a contagion. We call it an arms race. But if your neighbor's kid is getting an SAT tutor in the 10th grade, you can feel like you're cheating your kid to not get an SAT tutor in the 10th grade. And that's how we keep ramping each other up. And I'm going to talk about this tonight, but I'm in the process of getting a dean's commitment letter signed. And I think this letter will be signed, a commitment letter, by about 100 deans. And one of the things that they're going to say, if this all works the way I hope it will, is, and many of them have been saying this individually, but they're going to be saying it collectively, is that we will honor your curriculum. So if you decide that you don't want kids to take AP courses here, or you want them to take only two per semester, we will not penalize those kids in the admissions process because we understand the context in which those kids are working. And I think it is this kind of collective action that is the only way we're really going to break this problem. If the deans are willing to act collectively, and if schools and parents are willing to act collectively. Thank you. So I hope we have a chance to talk about that. Okay, let me just finish up with just a few general thoughts for us as parents about raising ethical kids. The first thing I want to say is I just think it's important to make caring a priority. And, you know, I have the reflex, many of you have the reflex, to say, all I want is for my kid to be happy, or all I want is for you to be happy. What if we said instead, all I want is for you to be kind? Henry James, is it Henry or William? I think it was Henry, said there are only three important things in life. The first thing is to be kind, the second thing is to be kind, and the third thing is to be kind. To hold our kids to high ethical expectations and put caring for others at the front and center in child raising. And by the way, I see some of you taking pictures, which is great, but I'm happy to share this PowerPoint with whoever wants to see. The second is to practice caring and gratitude. You know, by practice, learning how to be caring is in many ways like learning an instrument, about learning a sport. It's getting in the habit of doing things for other people and getting in the habit of helping around the house. I have to say, there's this debate around the country in some places about doing chores, and I feel like, of course kids should do chores. I mean, it's really important that kids pitch in and help others. And you know, in my house when my kids were young, sometimes they would set the table or clear the table and they would act like they should get a parade or a trophy. You know, you don't get a parade for clearing the table. This is what we do. And this is what I mean about developing a moral identity and developing these reflexes. This is what we do in this house. We help out other people. We help out people in the community. Sometimes we make sacrifices. It's a practice in our house. It's a day-to-day, week-to-week practice in our house. The third is expanding kids' circle of concern. So it's teaching kids how to zoom in and really listen deeply to another human being, but also how to zoom out to understand people who are different from them as they get older, to understand things like the Syrian refugee crisis, to really absorb the troubles of people who live in very different communities and cultures than they do. The fourth is discuss ethical questions. Kids are ethical philosophers. They love to talk about ethical dilemmas. I really wasn't accosting these six-year-old girls with my ethical dilemma. They really wanted to talk about it. Teenagers love to talk about it. They especially love to talk about questions involving romance and sexuality. And this is my research these days is in part around helping fighting misogyny and sexism and helping kids develop ethical romantic and sexual relationships. And kids really want to talk about questions about, like, well, what do I do if my best friend is cheating on her boyfriend and her boyfriend's also a friend of mine? I mean, these are obligations to talk about their responsibilities to other people and what to do when ethical values come in conflict. What do we do? Reflective modeling, all I mean by this is that as parents, I don't think the goal is for us to be perfect role models. I think the goal is for us to be flawed people who do the work of getting into the muck of ourselves sometimes and really understanding our flaws and being able to talk to our kids honestly about our flaws, particularly as they get older. And I don't mean burdening them with the responsibility of taking care of us, but I do mean being self-reflective modelers. And the final thing I will leave you with is the importance of helping our kids manage shame and other destructive feelings, envy, greed, pride, arrogance, because they are so important to our kids' moral development. But let me stop there, and I would love, I think, here's our website. I also have some materials for you. I'm not trying to promote, but if you want to be on our email list or if you want to see our resources, or research, it's all free, and we're delighted to share it with you. And I would love to take questions about this or about anything else that's on your mind. Anyone want to kick us off? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. I read your book years ago, but I'm struggling a bit with pride. Because I realized it's one of the seven deadly sins and how often it creeps in to, I'm so proud of you, or you must feel proud. And I haven't found another way to express that encouragement without going down. I'm worried about pride, but I'm conflicted.
Yeah.
So it's a struggle.
Well, as I ever since I've told my son I was proud of them, I've been a little gun shy about saying I'm proud too. But I think I feel about pride the same way about saying to our kids periodically that we really think they're wonderful or we really appreciate them. I do worry about telling our kids they're special. I really wish we would stop doing that, frankly. But I think it is absolutely fine to tell our kids are proud of them. Again, if it's based on some accumulated sense that they've done things that we should be proud of. And And all our kids will do things over time that we should be proud of. And I do think it's important to tell kids we're proud of them. What I worry about is just saying it too much, and I just think it becomes meaningless. And, you know, our kids are razor-sharp alert to authenticity. You know, they know if they've done something that's worthy of our pride or not. So that's really the distinction that I think is really important. Yeah.
So we should use random reinforcement like they do with rats instead. No, that's not my not my question. Are there living cultures or countries or religions that we can look outside America's border to that you feel or that this research and data suggest are doing it right?
You know, I mean, one thing it's a great question. You know, one thing that I would say about this is that, in many ways, we have been doing it right in this country. I mean, you know, our ethical life has many different dimensions. So, you know, for many of us, it's a really disheartening time right now. But if you look at the long trajectory over the last 50 years, 100 years, we've come a long way on race. We've come a long way on LGBTQIA issues. I thought we had come a long way on sexism, and in many ways we had come a long way on sexism. So, you know, this feels, and I know, again, I want to recognize that many of you may have different political positions, but this feels in terms of those things like it's a little moral shock. I mean, it's a setback. But in many ways, I think we are an ethical country and we are moving in the right direction and we have to keep moving in the right direction. So I want to say that. I think there are countries, you know, like the Netherlands and Holland. My daughter was there last year. I don't do research in other countries, and there's very little good research in other countries, that certainly have a history of building civil communities where there is more civil debate and there's also much more appreciation and tolerance across race, culture, and difference. There are certainly cultures, I mean, Costa Rica is known as one where people tend to be very collective and very kind. You know, again, there are also cultures that you find people are, you know, I was in Denmark, some of you may be from there. This could be a stereotype, I don't know much. But Denmark is one of those countries where I gather, you know, people were very friendly and very warm and is known for being a very strong collective, but also xenophobic and very anti-Muslim. So, you know, countries' moral lives are very complicated too.
We're here.
Yeah. You probably should use the microphone just so people.
I have a question for you. I'm right here to your left.
I'm sorry. Why don't we go with the mic first? Go ahead, and then we'll come back to you. Yeah, go ahead. Sorry.
I get into conversations with other parents quite often, and my kids are in kindergarten right now, so their kids happen to be around that same age. And a lot of parents look at their children as very special. You know, like this child has potential that is going to, like, it's like their dreams they're seeing in this child, and you hear them talking that way. And while you want to support the fact that, yes, all of these children are special, and they all say, yes, it's wonderful that, you know, by and large, we raise our children to be caring for others, at the same time, I want to make sure my child remains very special and give them all the opportunities and satisfy all their curiosities. So it becomes very, you know, myopic in the context of their own child. And I don't want to demean that conversation by saying that they don't care, because they certainly do. I think they're trying to figure out how to manage all of that. So how can I engage them, or how can we all engage each other in a conversation that allows people to see that by fostering caring, we're not decreasing the potential of that child for achievement? So, you know, giving it all due respect.
So it's a great question. It's very much at the heart of what I'm talking about. One of the things that I am arguing here or advocating for here, and this is a school that's primarily gifted kids, right? So this issue around specialness must be a big issue here. So, you know, one of the things I did just to respond to your thought about telling kids they're special. I mean, I think there's a real risk in telling kids they're special that you're telling them, they're hearing it, that you're better than other people are, And that seems something that, like something you want to fight tooth and nail and not convey that message. That's very different from saying you have some special qualities or some very important qualities. So that distinction seems very important to me. I am arguing that in every community should do a kind of audit and to really think about what are we prioritizing caring in the same way we're prioritizing achievement? Are they on the same, in the same ballpark? Are they really at the same level? And, you know, we have a survey. We have about 75 schools that are participating. You might have a survey where we ask kids, what's prioritized in this school? And, you know, most kids say what's prioritized by their parents and by their schools is achievement, not caring. I think if we're really serious about this, we would give our kids this survey in the fall, and then we would really think about how do we what would it really mean to be a school or a community where caring lived and breathed to the same degree that achievement lived and breathed. And then we would ask kids again in 6 months or a year and see if we saw any movement. And you could just ask that one question, you know, see if you saw any movement on that question. Are we really creating classrooms where there is a strong emphasis on helping out other people? When kids are graded on a curve, will they help other people knowing that it might hurt their grade in some way, which is something that we want to teach our kids to do? Are kids helping each other in the college process, or are they just competing with each other in the college process? I mean, if we're really serious about caring, those are the kind of metrics that I think we will hold ourselves accountable for. I think schools should have, sorry, you got me on a little bit of a rant about this, but, you know, I think schools, you know, one thing that drives me crazy, I don't know if this happens here, but a parent recently said to me who goes to his kid goes to a very high-powered private school in Boston, that there's another kid in his kid's class who had a serious behavior problem, and he wanted to go talk to the teacher, and he's saying to me, I'm paying, you know, $40,000 for my kid to go to the school. I want that kid out of the class. What do I say to the teacher? And this is a guy who cares very much about ethical character. But he's not understanding that as a parent, he has to demonstrate ethical character in relation to the school. He has to be not just about his own kid, but about every kid in the building. You know, he has to be able to say, that's a kid in our community, and go to the teacher and say, what can I do to support that kid? Or what can my kid do to support that kid? And if it doesn't work out, maybe that kid does need to be removed, but at least let's go through the first step. And I've been encouraging schools to have a kind of compact with parents where they, you know, that really articulates what their responsibilities are as a member of this community for other kids in the building as well as their own. This is not a comprehensive list, and we have other lists, you know, other things on our resources, but I do think that these are the kind of things that are really like where the rubber meets the road. It's really about what walking the talk is about. Yeah, whoever wants to grab the microphone, you've been very patient. Thank you. Go ahead.
Thank you so much. This question is about recent events, and if you have any advice to parents about how to talk to our children about ways, taking into account everybody's differing feelings about things, but how do we talk to our children about making sense of the difficult and kind of insulting rhetoric that they will have heard and that seems to be celebrated?
Yeah. So it's a great question. And let me say a couple of things. I don't know if it'll reach you up here, but I was just on a show at NPR in Los Angeles yesterday about this issue, and there were a number of people talking about it. And it's going to be aired today, but there'll be a number of people speaking to this issue. It may be helpful to you. And I just also want to say I was very aware of this yesterday. That, you know, like, again, I want to respect that people have different political views in the room, but like many of you, I am reeling from what happened last week and trying to figure it out. So I would really love other people's thoughts about this too. I mean, I hope we can brainstorm together about what makes sense. A couple of things do seem very important to me in this. I mean, one is certainly being allies with people who are vulnerable. LGBTQIA folks, immigrants, if that's how we feel about the immigrant issue, certainly Muslims. And, you know, it's standing by and standing up for people and being an ally. Another thing that I think is very important is that, you know, I think a lot of people voted for Trump. Some people voted for Trump because of his bigotry, But I think a lot of people voted for him despite his bigotry. I think they voted for him for other reasons. I think that, you know, economic security was a huge issue in this election, and they thought he was going to bring economic security. And I think it's important to separate Trump from the people who voted for him and not demonize or dehumanize the people who supported Trump, categorically, certainly. And to be able to have conversations. I mean, this is something I really think we need to do. I feel like we need to do at Harvard, because my guess is that if we had held an election at Harvard, it would have been about 95% Hillary supporters. And that we really need to hear people's other political views and teach our kids how to do two things. This conversation about empathy is confusing, because when people say, you know, I don't want to empathize with someone who's a bigot, I get that. But I don't think the goal is empathizing in the sense of appreciating a bigoted view. I think the goal is listening to somebody respectfully and with dignity, and often disagreeing with them vigorously and fiercely when they express political beliefs that are discriminatory. But both those things seem important to in terms of our kids and going forward, is being able to engage people respectfully and not dehumanize them, and being able to vigorously oppose beliefs that that are discriminatory and harmful to other people. Those are a few thoughts I have. Does anyone else have thoughts they want to share about this? Or? Yeah, no, I think that's right. And I think that is another form of disillusionment that people are experiencing, because they feel like the person who really worked hard and stood for the right things and took this, took the high road in many cases, didn't win. And that's a hard and very disillusioning thing. But that is life, right? I mean, that's going to happen sometimes. It's going to happen sometimes to our kids. It's going to happen sometimes to us. And we have to move on and think about paths forward. I think that's right.
I feel like we should focus on understanding why people voted the way they did. Yeah. And I think we have a serious economic issue, and a lot of people feel very disenfranchised.
Yeah.
And we live in a bubble out here, and there's a lot of, my mother lives in upstate New York, and there's a lot of people struggling day in, day out. And So I think rather than just being angry, we actually need to spend 4 years understanding why people are hurting so much that they would vote the way they do and how we help them.
I appreciate your point. And this is what I was saying about also separating some of the things Trump said from his supporters and why they voted for him. Because I do think there's a huge economic security issue, and lots of people out there clearly in the Rust Belt who are feeling marginalized and disenfranchised. But I don't think these two things are opposed. I think we can understand how those people are feeling, and we can really support jobs and other forms of economic security for them, and very fiercely oppose racism, sexism, homophobia, and all its forms. I think Bernie Sanders, you know, said this recently, and I think he was right. He, in a letter to Trump, he basically said, to the degree you're about really creating jobs for people and supporting the middle class and supporting working class folks, I'm all for you, I'm gonna work with you. But the degree you're about, you know, homophobia and sexism, I'm gonna oppose you tooth and nail. And I think that's right.
Hi. My little girl is really caring and always thinking of other people, which I'm proud of. But I see her getting shot down a lot by other children around her, when she offers to do things. And it's hard to keep her on track to be that way as she's getting a little bit more, older, and seeing the behavior of other children being a little bit more into themselves or selfish. So do you have any advice?
Well, I guess I would say a couple of things. You know, if you are in a community, and this doesn't seem to, I'm not sure what community your daughter is in right now, but if you're in a community where your daughter is feeling like she's belittled or you know, marginalized or bullied in some way, that's often a community problem. And, you know, it's really important to talk to a principal or a teacher or whoever about how the community is functioning and how and whether people are functioning with care in the community. It's also important to teach kids to deal with cruelty, which is going to happen to them sometimes. But those seem like, you know, the two things that one needs to do in that situation. And for her to have allies, and that's something else that you can help her with, is in figuring out how to have, in whatever situation she's in, how to have allies.
So I have a question about shame.
Where are you?
Festers. Hi.
Yeah, hi, sorry.
Are there concrete ways that you can help your child not feel shameful?
So, you know, I think this has to do with the conversation that we were having about self-esteem in a way, or that I was, you know, I was talking about self-esteem and happiness. And, you know, in the big picture, I think kids are much more likely to feel good about themselves or worthy or self-respecting, all of which counteract shame, if they do have self-esteem, but that we have mistaken notions about how self-esteem grows. That self-esteem doesn't grow developed by being praised primarily. I think self-esteem develops when people have really strong, respectful, caring relationships with people who really caring and respect them. I think self-esteem develops when people have meaningful accomplishments, when they accomplish things around things that are meaningful to them. I think, you know, self-esteem develops when kids are virtuous if they're in communities that are really valuing those virtues. You know, I think we have it wrong about how we build self-esteem. You know, many of us have been sort of building self-esteem the wrong way. The degree we are parents and educators who are creating this foundation for self-esteem, are giving kids opportunity for meaningful accomplishment, helping them develop strong, caring relationships, recognizing them when they do uncommon acts of kindness and they really are altruistic and are providing service, providing lots of service for them so they develop opportunities to care and to develop strong relationships. All those things counteract shame. I also just think, you know, it's really important to understand why kids are experiencing shame. It's not one thing. What is it that is driving any particular child to feel shame? Is it worry about achievement? Is it worry about appearance? I mean, there can be all kinds of things. And so part of it is understanding your individual child and what makes sense for your individual child. Yeah.
Hi. I have a question over here.
Hi. Thank you. Sorry.
Regarding the shame, that was actually part of my question. My other part is, what do you suggest or advise when you've raised your child in a way that they're very caring and they're the kind to help others and work together in groups and do all this, and then they reach the point where we are now and in the college application process where everybody has around them made this sort of choice to be very secretive and not work together and turn the entire lay of the land into a big kind of competitive cesspool?
Yeah.
How do you support children who are facing, in general, a more hostile environment than they're used to in that way?
Well, you know, the reason I said that this is a collective problem is because I think it is a collective problem. I mean, there are things I think you can do as an individual, but I also think it needs to be addressed collectively. And this is, you know, we have a school compact, which I'm happy to share with you, just as a template. It's things that parents can do and schools can do that they can agree on as a community. I mean, one thing, for example, is not broadcasting or publicizing the percent of your kids who go to highly selective colleges. It's being very diligent about exposing kids to a wide array of colleges, including colleges that are not high status. Parents could sign a compact about helping each other in the college process. Parents could sign a compact about taking other kids on visits with them when they're going to visits with their colleges. I mean, if we really, you know, I'm, I would love your thoughts about this. I mean, if we really want to get behind this, I think parents as groups have to be able to work collectively. The other thing that I'm saying, though, just to finish my thought, and then I want to hear your thought, is that even if parents don't work collectively, part of what I'm saying is that if your child is achieving a reasonable level and is a very caring person, they're going to get into a good college. I'm sorry, I just cannot emphasize that enough. It isn't about this 15 colleges. It's about hundreds of colleges. And until people turn that corner, it's just going to be very hard. Sorry, go ahead.
What I wanted to specifically ask is how to help the child who doesn't have the means to go to
So I guess I would say two things about this. One is that, I think in many ways this is a lifelong project, that all of us are going to be in situations with people who don't have the ethical commitments that we do. And that is something that we have to learn to live with, and we have to learn to stick to our ethical commitments. I mean, that's part of what having a moral identity and being a strong person is, and I think we should expect that from our kids. I also think, and I obviously don't know your son at all, but that there is a tendency that as parents and with kids, we see this in our kid data too. And again, I don't know your child at all, but pretty much, large majority of kids and parents think that they're caring and prioritize it, and other people are not and don't. And a large majority of other people don't. And again, this may not be true in your case. But I think we all need to do the self-reflection too. Is it really about all the other parents or all the other kids? Or is it about us, or at least partly about us?
So I think we're just going to take two more quick questions, and then we need to wrap up. So.
If I'm understanding your point, I think this is a very important point. When you look at the data could not be clearer. Whether kids are successful is determined so much more by their family background and their personal characteristics than what college they went to. I mean, if you look at data of kids who got into Harvard and got into a state school and decided for financial reasons to go to a state school, those kids, on every measure, do about as well as the kids who chose to go to Harvard. I mean, it really isn't about the college that you went to. And the data is very strong about that. But sorry, you said one other thing that I think I didn't respond to.
I was just commenting on the stress that the kids go through. It's not just college applications.
Then it starts at the.
And the stress seems to have come to children who are really too young. At 10 or 11, I think to be coping with a lot of that. Yeah. It's a little challenge that I'm watching our fifth graders in our school really
Well, you know, I don't know what else to do. You know, I've heard that this is happening in middle school in the Boston area too. I've been talking to middle school heads about this. You know, again, I think that this is really, I'm delighted that all of you are here, that this is something parents and schools really need to be very active about, and they need to have understandings and compacts about this kind of thing. We're not going to talk about college and middle school. It's just not going to happen. We're not going to engage parents in these conversations. It's just not part of what we're doing. And, you know, these are hard conversations to have, and sometimes they're hard because I know there's also, I don't know this community, but in Boston, the independent schools are competing with each other. They're worried that if they, you know, take a strong stand on something like that, the parents are going to go to some other school. But then the independent schools in the area need to get together. I mean this, and they need to say, and I was just talking to a group of independent schools in the Southwest that are going to do this, that as a group of independent schools, none of us are going to do this. Like, that's just something we're not going to do. No talk about college and middle school. No talk about college till junior year. We're at that point where we have to get there. Yeah.
I want to thank you.
That's our last question.
Last question. I want to bring it back up to the bigger world. Today we're talking about moral and caring, and I think this conversation has never been more important than right now. Yeah. I have bigger kids in college and younger kids, and I want to ask you to help us how to explain to especially my older kids how the highest person in government right now he's espoused a lot of hate rhetoric, and he has been proud that he didn't pay his taxes, and he's really been very amoral in the positions, and he's been nominated as the highest position in the country. How do we explain this to our kids right now, and can you help us how we would explain it to our kids?
My guess is you voted for Hillary.
I don't want to turn it into politics. I want to talk about it from a moral caring perspective. We're expanding our circle of caring.
Yeah.
So how do we take that out of politics? And because we have a real issue now, we want to teach our, this is a learning moment.
Oh, I agree
with
you.
How do we turn it into a parenting moment?
I agree with you. I've had lots of conversations with my kids about this. I mean, one thing that I was trying to articulate earlier is that, I do think that there are people who voted for Trump because he made bigoted comments, but I think there are a lot of people who voted for Trump despite the fact he made bigoted comments. I talked to a couple of Republicans who I play basketball with, for example, and they basically said to me, they're both jerks. I mean, a lot of people can't stand Trump. He's got incredible unfavorability ratings. I think Hillary's, I'm not agreeing, this is what they said. I think Hillary's crooked. I think he's an awful person. But I'm a Republican, so I'm going to vote Republican. I care about Republican policies. I care about things like being pro-life. I mean, so there are a lot of people who are voting for him, not because he said what he said, but despite the fact that he said what he said. So, you know, that's one conversation that I've been having with my kids. Somebody else brought up the issue of economic security, and it's a huge issue, right? I mean, if you look at the map and what happened, it's a huge issue. And, you know, I understand if you really believe that this guy is going to bring jobs back to your community, and you're worried about your family's livelihood, and you think about some of the things that Bill Clinton did, that you might vote for this guy. I think it's complicated that way. I'm not saying that I'm not terribly troubled by this, who our president is, but I think that there are explanations that are very important for our kids to hear. You know, the other thing is, and I'm older than many, almost all of you, probably all of you, I don't have any, but, you know, I lived through Nixon, I lived through Reagan. I think Trump is creepier in many ways, I will say that. But there are things that were really disturbing about both of them, too, for those of us who are Democrats. And I think we will live through this, and I think people who are older need to tell our kids that we will live through this, too, and that we need to stay in the fray. We need to get in the fight here, and it's very important to get in the fight.
Can you add at the very end of the gospel?
Yeah, so I can close with that because that is really what I'm trying to say here. And I just wrote a piece about this, that there are really two goals. That, you know, I think the group that needs to expand is the group that is really willing to fight for people who are vulnerable right now and who are willing to work across the aisle, to really engage people that have been foreign to them and unfamiliar to them. This is the message that I'm giving to my students, too, very strongly, and that we're talking about, is that you really shouldn't back off one inch from these principles you believe in, but you also have to engage and unite with people who, for whom other values are more paramount right now. And that's a hard thing to do.
Okay.
All right, thank you. Thank you all.
Dr. Weissbourd, we would like to thank you for being with us today and sharing your work. I know there's a lot of substantive and important material that I know many of us will continue to ponder beyond this morning. Thank you, Nueva, to hosting, and thank all of you for joining us.